Secret Garden by Frances Hodgson Burnett. When Mary Lennox was sent to Misselthwaite Manor to live with her uncle, everybody said she was the most disagreeable-looking child ever seen. It was true, too. She had a little thin face and a little thin body, thin light hair and a sour expression. Her hair was yellow and her face was yellow because she'd been born in India and had always been ill in one way or another. Her father had held a position under the English government and had always been busy and ill himself. And her mother had been a great beauty who cared only to go to parties and amuse herself. She had not wanted a little girl at all. And when Mary was born, she handed her over to the care of an ayah, who was made to understand that if she wished to please the memsahib, she must keep the child out of sight as much as possible. Mary never remembered seeing familiarly anything but the dark faces of her ayah and the other native servants, and they always obeyed her and gave her own way in everything, because the memsahib would be angry if she was disturbed by her crying. One frightfully hot morning, when she was about 9 years old, she awakened feeling very cross. And she became crosser still when she saw that the servant who stood by her bedside was not her ayah. "Why did you come?" she said to the strange woman. "I will not let you stay. Send my ayah to me." The woman looked frightened, but she only stammered that the ayah would not come, and when Mary threw herself into a passion and beat and kicked her, she only looked more frightened and repeated that it was not possible for the ayah to come to Missy Saab. There was something mysterious in the air that morning. Nothing was done in its regular order, and several of the native servants seemed missing, while those whom Mary saw slunk or hurried about with scared faces. But no one would tell her anything, and her ayah did not come. She was actually left alone as the morning went on, and at last she wandered out into the garden and began to play by herself when she heard her mother come out onto the veranda. She was with a fair young man, and they stood talking together in low voices. Mary knew the fair young man. She'd heard that he was a very young officer who had just come from England. The child stared at him, but she stared most at her mother. She always did this when she had a chance to see her, because the memsahib, Mary used to call her that oftener than anything else, was such a pretty person and wore such lovely clothes. "Is it so very bad? Oh, is it?" Mary heard her say.
"Awfully," the young man answered. "Awfully, Mrs. Lennox. You ought to have gone to the hills 2 weeks ago." The memsahib wrung her hands.
"Oh, I know I ought," she cried. "I only stayed to go to that silly dinner party. What a fool I was."
At that very moment, a loud sound of wailing broke out from the servants' quarters.
"What is it? What is it?" Mrs. Lennox gasped.
"Someone has died," answered the officer. "You didn't say it had broken out among your servants."
"I didn't know," the memsahib cried. "Come with me, come with me." And she turned and ran into the house.
After that, appalling things happened, and the mysteriousness of the morning was explained to Mary. The cholera had broken out, and people were dying like flies. The ayah had been taken ill in the night, and it was because she just died that the servants had wailed in their huts. Before the next day, 3 other servants were dead, and others had run away in terror. During the confusion and bewilderment of the second day, Mary hid herself in the nursery and was forgotten by everyone. Nobody thought of her. Nobody wanted her. And strange things happened of which she knew nothing. Mary alternately cried and slept through the hours. When she awakened, she lay and stared at the wall. The house was perfectly still. She had never known it to be so silent before. She heard neither voices nor footsteps, and wondered if everybody had got well of the cholera and all the trouble was over. She wondered also who would take care of her, now her ayah was dead. There would be a new ayah, and perhaps she would know some new stories. Mary had been rather tired of the old ones. She did not cry because her nurse had died. She was not an affectionate child, and never had cared much for anyone. The noise and hurrying about and wailing over the cholera had frightened her, and she'd been angry because no one seemed to remember that she was alive. When people had the cholera, it seemed they remembered nothing but themselves. But if everyone had got well again, surely someone would remember and come to look for her. Almost the next minute she heard footsteps in the compound, and then on the veranda. There were men's footsteps, and the men entered the bungalow and talked in low voices. They seemed to open doors and look into rooms.
"What desolation," she heard one voice say. "That pretty, pretty woman. I suppose the child too. I heard there was a child, though no one ever saw her."
Mary was standing in the middle of the nursery when they opened the door a few minutes later. The first man who came in was a large officer she'd once seen talking to her father.
"Barney," he cried out, "there is a child here. A child alone, in a place like this. Mercy on us, who is she?"
"I am Mary Lennox," the little girl said. "I fell asleep when everyone had the cholera, and I've only just wakened up. Why does nobody come?"
"It's the child no one ever saw," exclaimed the man, turning to his companion. "She's actually been forgotten."
"Why was I forgotten?" Mary said. "Why does nobody come?"
The young man, whose name was Barney, looked at her sadly.
"Poor little kid," he said. "There's nobody left to come."
It was in that strange and sudden way that Mary found out that she had neither father nor mother left, that they had died and been carried away into the night, and that the few native servants who had not died had left the house as quickly as they could, none of them even remembering that there was a Missy Saab. That was why the place was so quiet. Mary had liked to look at her mother from a distance, and she thought her very pretty, but as she knew very little of her, she could scarcely have been expected to love her or to miss her when she was gone. She didn't miss her at all, in fact, and she gave her entire thought to herself, as she'd always done. What she thought was that she would like to know if she was going to nice people, who would be polite to her and give her her own way, as Haria and the other native servants had done. She knew that she wasn't going to stay at the English clergyman's house where she was taken at first. She didn't want to stay. The English clergyman was poor, and he had 5 children nearly all the same age, and they wore shabby clothes and were always quarrelling. Mary hated their untidy bungalow and was so disagreeable to them that after the first day or two, nobody would play with her. By the second day, they'd given her a nickname which made her furious. It was Basil who thought of it first. Basil was a little boy, and Mary hated him. She was playing by herself under a tree, just as she'd been playing the day the cholera broke out. She was making heaps of earth and paths for a garden, and Basil came and stood near to watch her.
"Why don't you put a heap of stones there and pretend it's a rockery?" he said. "There, in the middle." "Go away," cried Mary. "I don't want boys. Go away."
For a moment, Basil looked angry, and then he began to tease. He danced round and round her and made faces and sang and laughed.
"Mistress Mary, quite contrary, how does your garden grow? With silver bells and cockle shells and marigolds all in a row."
He sang it until the other children heard and laughed too, and the crosser Mary got, the more they sang, and after that they called her Mistress Mary quite contrary when they spoke of her to each other, and often when they spoke to her.
"You're going to be sent home," Basil said to her, "at the end of the week, and we're glad of it."
"I'm glad of it too," answered Mary. "Where is home?"
"She doesn't know where home is," said Basil. "It's England, of course. Our grandmama lives there and our sister Mabel was sent to her last year. You're not going to your grandmama. You have none. You're going to your uncle. His name is Mr. Archibald Craven."
"I don't know anything about him," snapped Mary.
"I know you don't. You don't know anything. Girls never do. I heard father and mother talking about him. He lives in a great big old house in the country and no one goes near him. He's so cross he won't let them. He's a hunchback and he's horrid." "I don't believe you," said Mary. She turned her back and stuck her fingers in her ears because she would not listen any more.
Mary made the long voyage to England under the care of an officer's wife who was taking her children to boarding school. She was very much absorbed in her own little boy and girl and was rather glad to hand the child over to the woman Mr. Archibald Craven sent to meet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.